Alright guys, so I've decided I wanted to make a tutorial video on cinematography. I've done a little bit of cinematography work, and I've learned a lot over the years, and I keep learning every single day, so I know people just starting out with this stuff have a lot to learn, and even when we think we know a lot, then we learn something new. I learned something new today, and I'm going to teach you basically every single thing that I know in terms of cinematography. This is going to be part one of two videos. This one's based solely on camera work and angles and lenses and stuff, and then the second part's going to be completely on lighting, because that is an in-depth monster that I would want to really talk about fully in a separate video.
The star that gives us light has been gone a while, but it's not an illusion.
Okay. I want to start with one thing, though, or two things, actually, that you should know if you're getting into this stuff, just because I thought it was interesting. But George Lucas he was the one that engineered the first digital filmmaking camera. So the reason why we can do the things we do today is because of him. So as much as he kind of screwed up Star Wars, he's a pioneer. Other thing, lately I've been filming on the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera. It's absolutely incredible, so a lot of the stuff you see in this video, a lot of footage will be from this camera. The Blackmagic cameras, they have done something that I couldn't even imagine them making. For the price that they are and what you get out of them, like, they're probably the best digital cameras pretty much ever made. The rule of thirds, and I'm kind of going to break it down in a way where you're trying, so that you'll kind of understand what you're doing and not just the rule. And basically, when you're trying to frame a shot, a lot of people use this rule, and it's you're trying to balance the left side and the middle and the right side. But you're also trying to balance the images of the top, middle, and bottom. But not only that, you're also creating layers. You're creating layers this way, and you're making a background, a midground, and a foreground. So making those layers actually makes the shot more interesting and more dynamic, and it makes it feel more like a 3D picture. When you go about framing a shot, you kind of want to think about it a certain way. One thing that really helped me was when I heard that Alfred Hitchcock used to like to compose his images as if each of them were like a portrait or a painting. And so when I think about it, I don't even really use the rule of thirds. I just look at it and try to see what shapes I can capture in that frame. The most important thing is capturing beautiful images in that frame. It really is good to just use your eye and, you know, move the camera around a little bit and see, like, how it looks from this angle. Try to see if it looks better from if you rotated the camera a little bit or if you put the camera lower or higher. You just kind of have to look at it, you know? Some tools that you're going to need for basic stuff. And it's not, I mean, it is basic, but at the same time, it'll give you the ability to get the shots that are more than just average. So, of course, get a tripod, right? Yeah, that's gonna be your first thing. Second thing, this is probably my favorite and most important tool. It's a slider, and basically you can use it to get shots and slide the camera across horizontal, or you could go this way and it kind of becomes like a mini dolly. So those are things I also think are really important in terms of cinematography. Is an image can look good if you compose it well, but a trick to kind of make it look a little bit better is to have the camera moving just a little bit, whether it's like a little slide across, whether it is that dolly where you push in or you push out, or if you're or even when it's on a tripod and you just like tilt the camera a little bit, or you pan, it adds something to it. Other tool that's extremely important, Steadicam. And this will basically allow you to make shots that you would never have gotten otherwise. You can move through a set, you can move on location, you can even use it to film like a whole scene in one shot. And the thing I like to think about it though is not just using it to move, but thinking about framing, right? You keep those compositions in mind, of like you want it to look like a painting, right? But every time you move this, it should still, even if you create a new composition, they should still be a well-composed composition too. And that's another thing that will make it just better than good. These things, they're called ND filters. The way you get shallow depth of field is you have to put the camera settings in a way that it will let the most amount of light in as possible. But when you do that and you go outside, everything looks way too bright and it's like really blown out and everything, right? But these will allow you to cut the amount of light that's being let in, but still keep those settings in the camera the same. So it'll darken the image, but still let you keep that shallow depth of field that you're trying to get. Other good tool is lens hood, screws on the top. This is supposed to block random light coming in from different angles, so that, because sometimes lens flare, personally, I really like lens flare. I think it's really attractive, but other times it kind of gets in your way, and if you don't want it there, this will block it out. The other thing it does, like the when the lens flare, when the light hits the lens, sometimes it kind of, it almost looks like there's light in front of the subject. So it's almost like a cloud, like a really thin cloud of light that's in front of the thing. And then this will, when you put this on, it basically gets rid of it. Zoom lenses versus prime lenses. They both have their uses. I would say if you're doing more documentary stuff, or you're actually on location in an environment where you're trying to capture things at like an event or something, use zoom lenses, because it allows you to adjust quicker, zoom in on whatever you're trying to get, and it's more convenient, it's functional. Functionality is really, really important when you're being a cinematographer. Prime lenses you would use more for like film, music videos, anywhere that you would have the most control of your own environment. And basically the difference is, zoom lenses, duh, they zoom, right? You can change the focal length and what you're actually going to capture in focus with the camera. Prime lenses, they have a fixed focal length, so you can't zoom with them at all. But the thing about that is that all the power and the engineering that goes into these like creates that one focal length to be the most crisp and the prettiest that it can be. So prime lenses look prettier than zoom lenses. Some people can tell, some people can't. I mean, because like originally I couldn't tell. It's dumb. But honestly, they're good. They're awesome. Now I kind of want to read from this, if you're wondering why I had a book. But I asked somebody who's just getting into this stuff, you know, he's in high school, he's looking to get into video work, and I asked him what kind of questions he had about cinematography and being director of photography and things like that. So I thought he asked some really good questions, and one of them is, how do you know what style of cinematography to use, like for a specific genre or, you know, just a scene? And I guess the way that I would answer that is, you kind of just have to think about what you want the audience to feel in that moment. If you had like a standard scene, normally, like, you know, if there's not that much emotion involved, you stick to basic shots that are still, and you go from like a wide to like a medium, and you know, it's fine. But if you're trying to actually create like a feeling, like say someone's in distress, right? There's a shot and it could still look good with your actor being really miserable. But if you wanted to add a little bit to that, to pull some emotion, a lot of the time you would take the camera and you would kind of do like a handheld. You would take the camera and do kind of a handheld thing with it, and just make it move just a little bit. It gives it a little bit more life, and it kind of also makes you subconsciously uncomfortable, because you're wanting that shot to be still, but it's not. It's uneasy. If you wanted something to seem more epic or more cinematic, you would want definitely more moving shots in it. So like use the slider, use the dolly. That's epic. Use a lot more wide shots and medium shots. They will give you that epic scope that you're looking for. If you're looking for to create a mood of intimacy, you would use more close-ups and a little bit tighter medium shots. The one thing that I noticed is like the most intimate. Over-the-shoulder shots are very attractive, but so even if you're doing close-ups, if you have someone else in that frame too, even if you can barely see them and they're slightly out of focus, that creates the most intense intimacy that you can have for any scene. And the term for it is a dirty shot. So this is clean, this would be dirty. What is the most efficient way to get shots? The most efficient way to get shots, that's a good question. Say like you have a deadline and stuff. Don't ever get on set without have already scouted the location. Make sure you know what's there. Make sure that you've already planned out all the shots you're gonna get. You have a storyboard, you have a shot list. So that once you get there and your actors are there, then all you have to do is set that up and hit record. The lights should already be done too. It's not really a style choice, it's just being prepared. Is there such thing as too much of one shot? I would say it kind of depends. Personally, I think that you should have somewhat of a balance in the kind of shots that you get. You shouldn't have everything be a wide shot. You shouldn't have everything be a close-up. Because close-ups are really pretty innately, especially when you have that shallow depth of field. But you want those to kind of be more insert shots and, you know, medium shots to be kind of the focus. But, like, having a wide shot every now and then, like a really nice, well-composed wide shot in between the scene, actually really helps. It gives your eyes a rest, something different to look at, and again, like I said before, it kind of creates that more cinematic look to it. So I think you should balance your shots, but that's the way that I do things. Doesn't necessarily work for everyone, doesn't mean that everyone has to do it that way. That's just what I think.
Some people ask about how to make something look cinematic, and a lot of the things that I just told you are going to help with that, but another thing to think about is frame rate, and know how to use it, and know what each frame rate kind of is generally used for. 30 frames per second is a television standard, so if you want something to look more like a TV show, or if you're filming like a web series, or that's when you would probably want to use 30 frames per second. If you don't know what that means that the camera's taking a certain amount of pictures, and so when you play it back, you're watching 30 pictures go by every second. The film standard, or traditionally, is 24 frames per second. So that's one way to go if you are trying to make something look more like a movie. You would want to use 24 frames per second. But there's also a setting on a lot of cameras that goes up to 60 frames per second. And that one you would use if you wanted a slow motion effect, because the camera's taking more pictures, which means that if you slow it down, there will be like a smoother motion instead of it being jittery or just weird looking. The sweet spot for converting the 60 frames per second in that 24 frames per second timeline, say you have a movie, you shot it all in 24 frames per second, and you shot one little sequence in 60 frames per second, and you want to make it go in there, you have to slow down the clip to 40%, and that will be basically perfect for slow motion.
Technically, there kind of is a way to overdo something. I think that there should be a purpose when you move the camera. And like I said, it makes things look more attractive. But say Michael Bay, he makes every single shot move, and people really aren't impressed anymore. They don't think his cinematography that he uses in movies is that great. And some of the shots actually are really good, but it's just, if there's no reason for the shot to move, then it's not doing anything for the story, which is what I'm going to get into next. You have to think about, again, what are you trying to make the audience feel? If you're trying to introduce something, normally you start with an establishing shot. So, you know, like a nice wide to kind of like show the environment that you're in. And sometimes, if you're going into that place, a lot of the time you'll dolly in. Or like if you're trying to introduce a character for the first time, you would push in to that person, and kind of it makes you feel closer to them, and it's kind of taking you into that story. Say there's a turning point in the story, or you're trying to reveal something, then the composition should change. You should see one thing and then move the camera to create a new composition to where you reveal something or somebody new. That helps you tell the story. Think about what it means when you're creating a shot. Do you want this person to look like they're happy? Do you want them to look alone? And another way to create someone feeling alone or just like lost in the world, you would show them and create all this negative space around them. So they're they only take up a small portion of the frame, and then to make it even more, to make them feel even more alone, you would dolly out. So that makes the negative space around them even bigger. When you're filming with multiple cameras, basically you have to put the camera that is shooting the widest image in front. The other cameras should be to the side or behind it, getting the close-ups and insert shots. It's easier to do on a set than it is to do documentary style when you're out in the field, but basically, it's just planning. It's doable. If you're a director of photography, then you should be concerned with trying to get the best in-camera stuff as possible. Make sure that you're white balanced. Make sure that the lighting looks the way you want it to and has the right contrast or lack of contrast. Make sure what you want to be in focus is in focus. Anything else is the director's call and the editor of what wants to be done in post. Adapting is a very useful tool. As a cinematographer, as a filmmaker, as anything, you need to be ready to adapt to any situation. So I'm the kind of person that will make something work for me. I will change things as they come, but in certain situations you definitely will need certain things, and if it's not working, then you let go and you move on. After doing a little bit of cinematography work for other people, basically, what I've understood is the first rule is listen to the director. That's the first rule. Get what they want. You are going to have some directors that are a lot more specific and some directors that will give you more freedom to figure out how you want to visually tell a story. And sometimes they don't know exactly how to express what they want, but your job is really to be the translator, to capture what they have in their head and to use your ability and your equipment at your disposal to capture those images that are in their head. One of the most important things is taking your own ego out of the equation. I think the thing that you should strive for is that every single shot in whatever you're filming is perfect and is the image that you wanted, the image that the director wanted, and is attractive to the eye, because it makes a heck of a lot of difference when you look at something and instead of seeing a few pretty shots in there, that you see every single one of them is beautiful. And it's almost like a subconscious thing. Cinematography is so important because it affects the way people perceive a story. Some people will notice, but a lot of people won't. It's a subconscious thing. They're looking at something, and if it's more attractive to the eye, they're going to end up liking it more than the same exact thing, and it's not attractive. But the other thing to think about is, if you're trying to make someone feel uncomfortable, then maybe you don't want the shot to look as pretty. So, going into telling a story through visuals, if you want them to feel uncomfortable or you want them to feel disgusting, then you're not trying to make the shot look as perfect and pretty. So just adjust depending on what you want the audience to feel. All right, well, I think that that's everything that I've learned. I know that there's probably some more thoughts in my head, but those hopefully are useful tips for people that are just starting out or maybe are somewhere where I am in life. So please take those to heart, and I will continue the next part about lighting and everything I know about that. So thank you guys, and I'll see you next time.